The Triple B Podcast would like to invite you to come break bread with your brothers. If you like what you're hearing on the show, if you think we missed the mark, or if we got it all wrong, reach out to us on social media. We can be reached on Twitter at @triple_B_pod or search Brothers Breaking Bread Podcast. We are the Brothers Breaking Bread on Facebook, and our email is brothersbreakingbreadpod@gmail.com. Further descriptions are in the show notes. Like, follow, friend, do all that good stuff. And please, never forget to break bread with your brothers.
How y'all doing? We out here, chilling in the spot. What up? How y'all doing? We out here, chilling in the spot. What up?
What's going on, y'all? Brothers Breaking Bread Podcast in the house.
Hey! We're having a little
pop-up.
It'll be good.
Yeah, let's make it happen. Let's not just talk about it.
This is a beautiful thing, man. It's all this blackness, and we all just getting together, playing dominoes, eating, we drinking.
And, you know, food is always just the extra, man.
They deprive these people of their basic human rights, you know, and we call ourselves Americans. We're supposed to be above all this.
They'll fake the crisis. They'll make it seem way out of proportion.
Brothers, we breaking bread.
How y'all doing? We out here, chilling in the spot. What up?
Trying to hold it all together, man. Life is moving fast right now,
man. So it's good to have everybody out there.
I love that, man. I love it a lot more than I could say to you guys.
Be broke, 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 fat broke. We ain't got it. Broke, 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 fat broke. We ain't got it. Don't spend no money. Ain't got no clothes. Ain't got no cars, ain't got no hoes. We broke, 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 five broke. We ain't got it, broke, 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 five broke. We ain't got it, got no money, got no money. We got no clothes, got no clothes. Ain't got no car, ain't got no car. Can't get no hoes. We broke, 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 broke. Bunch of niggas broke, 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 broke. We broke, 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 five broke.
Broke, 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 five broke.
We ain't got it. The nigga Kanye is trying to pledge again. Broke fight broke. We bringing this nigga back to the frat.
Maybe that nigga is really a prophet.
Ain't got no money. Ain't got no clothes. Adidas gone. Take my hoes.
I was like profiting shit right now.
Oh, man. Hey, welcome, welcome, welcome. Once again, an installment of the Brothers Breaking Bread. Let's go around the room. Let's talk to our sister first. Ada, you in the building.
Hey.
What's up with it?
Hey, it's another Friday, and it's been a crazy week. So St. Louis became the latest place that had a school shooting this week. Right down the street. Pretty much down the street from where I live, around the corner and down the street a little bit, not too far from my school. That was on Monday morning. And by Monday night, we had some kind of copycat kids putting messages up on Snapchat that they wanted to, between 9 and 3 on Tuesday, they were going to shoot up the school. And they got them, superintendent, principal, and police got them Monday night, Tuesday. More than half the kids were absent. Wednesday, more than half the kids absent. Thursday, more than half the kids absent. Friday, today, we didn't have school because we had parent-teacher conferences. Yay! So another long-ass week of school with all of that. So it's been a long week, but it was a good week. It was productive with, I think, the reassurance of the kids, like letting them know that the school is safe. The fire marshals were there on Tuesday morning.
Wait. It wasn't your school, was it?
No, it was not my school. I've worked at that school as a coach before, but it was not a school that I work at.
What school was it?
The shooting happened in Central Visual and Performing Arts, CVPA. Okay. It's a co-shared building or co-located school, so there's another school also in that same building with them.
Okay.
And both schools were evacuated. Both schools are going to be virtual until after Thanksgiving, and then they'll both go back to school. I'm not even sure if they're going to be in the same building, but they will be back in person after Thanksgiving.
Wow.
Crazy.
Yeah, like I heard from you. I heard from I got another chat group with you know, guys from college. And I don't know if you guys remember Jimmy Williams. I don't know. He used to be at the rec center hooping a lot. But he said that he had a niece, I believe, who was marked, you know, cool, but I think might have gone to the school. So
yeah, the degrees of separation that I'm seeing with all this, like the teacher who got killed was a PE teacher. She was a cross country coach, so you might have seen her places.
Wild.
And the kid, I've heard like several students at school talk about the girl that was killed. Was like a cousin of some people, or might have been friends with different people at the school I'm at. It's just like the degrees of separation and knowing people who know people. It's pretty crazy. Crazy, crazy. One of the first things I thought of when I heard about this was there was a podcast I listened to. I want to say it was in the summertime. It was sometime in the past year. And it was about school shootings and how after school shootings happens, I think since the very, well, not the first one, since it might have been since Sandy Hook, there's this parents who had their kid killed in a school shooting who now just go everywhere. As soon as there's a school shooting, they travel to that place and they meet with the victims and like talk to the victims about how the media is going to come at them and how they need to be careful about like hoaxes and how some people are going to say that their kids are not really dead and all this stuff. And my first thought was like, oh shit, these people are going to come here. Like they got to learn how to deal with the media. They got to learn to talk to people. It's like just ridiculous. But yeah.
Well,
other than that, I'm all right.
Yeah, the community's crying right now. So sorry to the to the people of St. Louis. I hope you guys heal.
Yeah.
Well, he's been away for a long time. I'm sure several diddlers have been hemmed up in the meantime. What's up, Tim?
What's up, y'all? I am back. And when I say I am back in the KC area. Yes. Just got settled in. I think I've been settled for about a couple weeks now. Getting everything together and stuff. Started my new job and everything. Loving it. It's just been a positive transition from being in New Orleans being back in Kansas City. So the plan is not to go anywhere. I'm stuck. I'm staying here. So everything is cool. I do have, like, I'm going to miss some people down there, but I'm definitely not going to miss their hospital.
You still there? Team, we lose you?
The people at his hospital said, you about to talk about us? Click. No more service for you.
Nigga, the diddler killer got diddler killed. They took a scalpel to that nigga, man. Talk shit if you want to at your own peril. Well, I don't know what's happened to my guy. Is he dropped out the chat?
Nah, he's still on the chat, but I don't know. He may be having some technical difficulties.
Yeah. Well, if he comes back in, we'll circle back. I had a bunch of questions this weekend. But I'm gonna hold on to it. Good brother. Slim AC, AC Slim. What's happening, Kevin?
Yo. City's a buzz, man. City's a buzz.
It is.
Championship baseball going on, so.
Got down 6-5 right now, though.
Yeah, I know, man. They just gave up the booty real quick. But on a brighter note, man, got out to KC. I appreciate you, Joe, man. Love you, brother, for just showing me some hospitality all weekend, man.
Absolutely.
Enjoy myself, man. I got everything done that I really wanted to get done. I didn't truly have a great just wanted to get back up to the old campus, see some of those stomping grounds, and see some friends and people who I haven't seen in years. And I was able to do that. You know, I even got to meet Tin in person for the first time, and Zeb, which was awesome, you know, because I know Zeb is, you know, like seeing Bigfoot. So
it is.
so I got to see Zeb in person, and, you know, it was all love, man. So I appreciate that.
So AC and Ida, did y'all know each other back in college?
I knew. I saw him on the. We might have talked a few times, maybe.
We knew of each other. We knew of each other and had acquaintances, but we didn't.
That's true. Because you, I think you knew some of my roommates or something like that. I don't know.
Yeah, we had acquaintances. You know what I'm saying? So we kind of knew of each other. We knew each other existed.
Did y'all meet?
I mean, we may have had conversations.
I had to talk to at some point. Yeah, I feel like at a party or.
Well, even in the restaurant and even Eva J's or Brady Commons. I mean, we've had like passing conversation, but nothing, you know, in depth to like I remember what we talked about on this day.
Right. So, with that being said, I feel like AC, you and I are the only two people who have met everybody on the podcast.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, man, you a pioneer out here.
Okay. I will roll with that. Groundbreaking shit right there.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
We got the
surprise from 10 last week. I didn't expect to run into him.
Oh yeah.
Hey, so
you got your audio figured out, man?
I will jump off here, like not jump off the call, but I'm gonna wrap up my check-in because I wanna defer my time to Brother Jefferson because I think he has questions. I defer my time to the senator from KC.
Uh-oh.
Hey, Tim.
What's up?
Yeah, we had some conversations last weekend, man. We were a little confused about some stuff. We were hoping you could clarify.
Okay.
Why'd you move up here?
Why did I move up here?
Yeah.
You want to be closer to home. Why?
That ain't what we heard.
Oh, God. Here we go. You know, I was pre-warned that this was coming.
Okay, well, you know what it is.
I already know what it is. I was pre-warned that this was coming. A little bird told me that she kind of slipped some verbiage out, and you know, so they're gonna kind of grill me on. A possible reason why I moved up here.
Is it a possible reason or is it the reason?
Huh?
So, let's be clear.
That's, yeah.
Honey Buns brought us some Honey Buns last weekend.
Oh, yes, she did.
And, oh, by the way, shout out, she also got us a plate from Gates, so everybody kind of ate from that.
Uh-huh.
So that was awesome. Yes, but she brought some Honey Buns for... AC and I and Roger came through and got some.
Okay.
And so we enjoyed that. I still got some left over.
Okay.
But in so doing, go ahead.
I say I got to swing by and get some.
Absolutely. And so doing, she let the cat out the bag. She had talked to you and said that the real reason you came up here was for a woman.
That's partially true.
So it's partially true.
Uh-huh.
So now it's partially true.
I'm serious. It's partially true.
Will this woman listen to the podcast?
No.
She's not going to listen to the podcast.
No.
Are you cohabiting with said woman?
I'm sorry?
Huh?
Say it again.
Excuse me?
I'm sorry. Repeat your question.
Are you cohabiting with said woman?
At the moment, yes.
At the moment?
Yes.
Nigga, do you live with her or not?
Yeah, I said yes. Damn.
You said at the moment. That was yes. That could have been for the night, or it could have been forever.
Yes, we cohabiting.
So my question is,
here we go.
What's up with the secrets?
What do you mean, what's up with the secrets?
Why we gotta find out from Kim?
I don't know. I guess I wasn't ready to tell y'all that and get grilled, because I knew I was going to be grilled.
Nigga, you got grilled because you didn't tell us, bro. If you told us, it'd have been like, oh, cool. He got a little woman up here. Cool. All right, man, good luck. Go get your donkey feet thing, man. Absolutely.
Yeah.
You getting okay. grilled because you trying to sneak, nigga. What the fuck's wrong with you, bro? I'm trying to figure this shit out.
All right, man. So, yeah, all right. Since the cat is out the bag, or as y'all say, and yes, I am currently cohabiting with a female that I had went to high school with. We were actually going together then. And then, you know, things happen, you know, time has passed, you know. And then we just reconnected and everything, and just went on from there.
How's she feel about grapes?
I don't need. She don't need.
I was gonna ask a great question. Have you guys been grocery shopping yet? Who does the grocery shopping at your house?
Hey, does she make sure she put the shit on the list, or does she just be out here randomly grabbing shit off the shelves, bro? That's right. That's what we really want to know.
I tell you this though, we did take a grocery shopping trip here recently, and it was good. It was pretty decent.
Also, she stuck to the script, huh?
Well, no, one too. She was all over the place too.
Did you pay for it though?
Yes, I paid for it.
You learned your lesson. Okay.
Something like that.
All right, man.
But no, I pay for everything.
Yeah. Okay, good. I was just questioning, bro, because the whole grape situation was a little shaky, especially what we found a year after the fact.
Oh man, here we go.
I'm just saying.
But no, grapes, man.
My God, Tim, how come every time we talk about grapes, we always get a mmm?
She was part of the reason why I moved down there.
Yeah, we found the fuck out a year later.
A year later, yeah.
After Roger put a deposit on the place. You lucky he not here, bro.
So anyway,
we was doing that all weekend, bro. We like, what's going on? I don't understand it.
I don't know.
Secrets from the group.
No. Let's bring one thing home. Like, here was my thing, Tim. Like, all that, like, everything with your personal situation was your personal situation with me. Here was my thing. I was like, you know, we had interacted maybe a little bit in the chat group.
Yeah.
But I, you know, technically, you hadn't been on a podcast maybe the last three or so.
Almost a month.
4 months. Three or four months.
Right. So I hadn't really heard your voice. I heard nothing from you. So we on the way to the game. Uh-huh. Remind you, I don't know nothing. And me and Joe's talking, and I get a text, and it said, well, in the group, it says, I'm here. And I was like, huh? Uh-huh. I was like, what is he talking about? And that's when I was like, oh, wow, you're at the game.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Nigga, you were actually, you did the Avengers shit to me in real life, bro.
Damn.
You showed up out of nowhere, nigga, like a superhero. Like, what the fuck is going on?
Oh, man. So, yeah, about that. So I had wanted to catch one of the games, you know, not knowing that this was going to be the season ender.
When you say games, we're talking about Rogers Twins high school football game.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So I had wanted to catch one of the games, you know, want to see the Twins play.
And I just reached out and asked, you know, out of the blue, just want asked Roger when they play next, and he told me, well, AC gonna be in town and whatnot. I'm like, oh, okay, cool. I'll meet y'all out there. And so that was just like something, I guess, just felt, you know, just kind of like.
That's what's up, though, man. I'm glad you did that. Bro, can I talk about how I felt like Friday night was real quick, though?
Oh, yeah.
Hold up.
Go ahead.
This nigga showed up at the game, and I wonder if that's how Jeffrey Epstein felt when he showed up in the cell. I was fearing for my life, bro. I thought this nigga was going to hang me for something, bro. Like, I ain't do nothing, bro. I ain't do nothing. I promise I didn't. Anyway, go ahead.
Nah, I was just going to say, I want to talk about how crazy and amazing, like, Friday night was, like, how wild a night that was. Yeah. Nigga, do you realize I met up with some niggas I literally hadn't seen in 20 years.
Uh-huh.
I met you for the first time. We got to watch an overtime football game of one of my best friends' high school twins play and a win. Nigga, yeah. We met Jim Harbaugh and nigga ate barehanded barbecue in the parking lot.
Yes.
What a fucking night.
That's good.
That was a night, man.
What a fucking night.
Yeah.
It was. Stuff legends are made of.
Yes. We got pictures to prove it, guys.
Shit, the next day wasn't any worse, bro.
Yeah, you're right.
Well, we went up to Columbia.
Uh-huh.
Met up with some of your old frat, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Yours too. They was out there.
They weren't old frat for me. They was new frat for me. But
they were new for you. You're right.
You know what I'm saying? Those were your people. But got to tour the facilities.
Okay.
Nigga, hey, there is no reason Mushu should ever lose a game. There is no reason.
How's it look compared to before? Is it real nice?
It
like even nicer, I'm sure.
So fucking ridiculous.
It is the top of the line. Like, you'd be hard pressed to find a school that has better facilities right now.
Mm-hmm. Adi, you remember facilities, right?
What'd you say?
You remember the weight room and the facilities and all that shit back over? It's nothing like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like everything you remember, fuck that. That's child's play.
And that shit was nice because they remodeled it when we got there.
Yeah.
No, this shit is. They have a fucking pharmacist on fucking site.
What? That's nice. That's what they need. That's a good thing too.
They have a in weight room nutritionist.
Wow.
They got the biggest hot tub in North America.
What? Why?
They took a lap pool and put like 16 heaters in there.
Mm.
With like 8 TVs around the bitch.
Wow.
Yes,
these hot niggas pool, have a cold sleep chamber.
Yes, a cryo sleep chamber. Yep.
Wow. Are you serious?
Yes.
Like one of only two schools in the country that has a damn sleep chamber.
Wow. This is kind of ridiculous.
Yes,
it's like Joe and I were standing there. Oh, Joe, we got to tell them we got this on white privilege and training.
Tell me about it. I don't remember what you're talking about.
The kids putting their head in the lion?
Oh, yeah, they was.
A real lion?
In a tiger. Yeah. We were touring with a group, and it was mostly, you know what I'm saying, AC's frat, a couple of ex-football players, an ex-track athlete. And then there was a white family. I don't know who they were related to or how they got in on it, but
they work for it. Yeah,
they work with DeWitt.
They work with DeWitt.
I got you. And so they brought a couple, I don't know, school age boys. Probably I say maybe 8, 9, somewhere in there. And they were just kind of like, we just learned how white people figure out that you can do whatever the fuck you want to do and there's going to be no consequences.
We had a fucking epiphany. Like, we had an epiphany right there as we was about to take a picture. Like, this is how it starts. This is where it happens.
They just walked up to the statue of the tiger, and then just stuck their head all the way the fuck in it. And Pop was like, "Oh yeah, go ahead and do it." I was like, "If that's a black parrot, goddamn it, somebody's head would have been snatched."
Exactly.
Get your ass over here.
Goddamn it! What the fuck's
going
on? No,
they are like, "No, do it. Take a picture. Like here, come here. Hold
no, your
together.
Turn. Now you go in there."
Nobody's gonna tell you shit. Do it.
You're white. It's okay.
like this is where it starts.
So I mean, we witnessed that. We witnessed the fucking forest fire.
We did.
Yeah. Yeah.
Boonville.
Like Boonville, like right where the bridge is. I don't know. You come
towards Kansas City.
Side. Yeah, towards Kansas City.
Okay.
Right where the bridge is, there was a
fucking. The north side or the south side?
The fucking west side.
Yeah.
No, but like of the highway.
Oh, of the highway.
And it was like.
It's heading east, so it's heading towards Columbia.
Okay. I would say the south side of the highway, but I'm not 100% sure it didn't jump the highway.
Was it intentional, or this was like a fire?
I
guess you might not be able to tell from just driving by.
Shit was lit the fuck up, bro. I don't know.
Forest That's was scary. On fire, so
yeah.
It was wild.
And then, like, fireworks went off.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's like fireworks right in the middle of it. So I was like, I don't know if... That's what makes me think it was unintentional.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was in the middle. It was, like, nighttime. We was heading back.
They have all those little side of the highway fireworks places over in those areas,
That's
too.
What I'm
like
saying.
Of July,
it might have got to a fucking
those
firework.
On fire.
Yeah, it might got to a fireworks depot, and we just got a show.
I know, nigga. We had a nigga Saturday, nigga. We had a fireworks show while we had a Pusha T concert in the fucking on I-70.
Yes, we did. Because I-70 was a fucking parking lot.
Oh wow,
damn.
Yeah,
nigga, watched fireworks and had a Pusha T concert, man.
Yeah, man. So all that, including seeing Zeb and. Yeah, man, we ate at Applebee's or no Chili's. So we had a good little weekend, man.
That's good.
We had a good little weekend. I'm gonna add I don't know. I guess your check-in became my check-in. They kind of rolled into each other. I gotta search my side eye.
Okay.
Random ass white people. I had a reporter hit me up, and what he's trying to do is he's written a story on Mona Lee. Mona Lee is my former assistant coach. She's a legend at my school. She was a 10-time state champion, which I believe was and maybe still is a state record in Missouri. The most decorated athlete in the history of LSU track and field, and a 2-time Olympic finalist. Sorry, 3-time Olympic finalist, 2-time Olympian. So, you know, somebody who I've grown close to within the last few years and that type of thing. I told y'all in the previous episode that I had gone viral. Mona Lee had commented on it, and this guy had done a story on her. So he hit me up, and he was like, yo, I want to get the track named for Mona Lee at Central. And I'm like, okay, you know the school is closing, right?
like why now,
man? Why the fuck are we pressed to get this track named in her honor? It should be named in her honor. It absolutely should be named in her honor. The school is closing. Why is this important now? You know?
Exactly.
And so he hits me up to do this. And I'm like, well, okay. Cross country's ended for me, so I'm not going to be there at 4 o'clock. He says, well, he has to be there at 4 o'clock. I tell him I'm not going to be, I'll be out of work at 2:30. I don't live far, but I'm not going to be there after 2:30. And he says, okay, cool. I'll see you at 4 o'clock at the school. And I was like, what? You didn't hear what the fuck I just said?
Not at all.
was like, white privilege is a motherfucker.
I was about to say.
So I gave him some shit about it. Basically, he just, I don't know. I think he's a little socially awkward. He, you know, was kind of singly focused on this task of trying to get Moon a track named after her. And, he basically acted like he knew me. I guess he had seen my post and just figured he knew me. You know what I'm saying?
You're so famous.
Yeah, I guess infamous, one or two, you know. So he started just kind of assuming shit. And I was like, yo, I just told you I'm not going to be there. Why the fuck would I leave work and then come back for work for a motherfucker who hadn't even introduced himself to me? You know what I'm saying? Right. So, you know, he saw that. He came correcting the conversation. And then I realized it was a professional development day, so I was going to be there anyway. So I stuck around till 4 o'clock, waited for him to show up, and then kind of gave him a tour of the facility, showed him some of the memorabilia from Mona Lee. Mm-hmm. And he is intent on getting her on the track renamed, and I'm for that, but I was just like...
Does he know the school is potentially closing soon?
He's been informed because I told his ass. I was like, why the fuck do we want to name a track at a closing school? I was like, okay, whatever, man. You know.
He needs the resume.
What is his process to make this happen? Like, how does this go? Like, what is he doing?
So he had talked to a school board member, and there's a story behind the school board member for me. I'm not going to talk about it on here. Okay. But we informed him that we have this weird cooperation with the city on our football field and track. It is part of a public park, Central Park, which is adjacent to Central High School. Mm-hmm. So we don't own our track.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm saying? That's not school district property. That's technically KC Public. I'm sorry, the Parks Department. It belongs to them.
Okay.
And so we have like a 100-year agreement with them where they have access to the pool, which is inside the building, and we have access to the track and football field, which is at the park. So, you know, he was trying to go through the school board to get it done, and I was like, well, you may need to check with the city council.
Parks and Rec.
Yeah, Parks and Rec, city council, that type of thing to get it named. So we shall see where it goes from there. Mm-hmm. But I just kind of stuck around and on Wednesday and, you know, gave him a tour and showed him some of the memorabilia, her school records, state championships, that type of thing, so...
That's cool though.
Yeah. So it ended up working out in the end, but I was like, yo, what the fuck is this dude doing?
He's exercising his white privilege.
Yes, he was. Yes, he probably put his head in the tiger when he was young.
Yo.
So anyway. That is what's going on. Speaking of White Lives Matter, the brother Kanye, what y'all think about him?
I try not to think about him, but he seems to always be in the news lately.
He is so omnipotent.
Hard for me to keep succeeding.
Yeah, he's everywhere. He's ubiquitous.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
That is he, you know.
So what about this nigga showing up to Skechers?
Well, hold on. Slow down on the Skechers. Why is this nigga showing up to Skechers? So these are the conversations I've been having, okay?
Okay.
To kind of summarize the situation, Kanye was going on. He's been on another one of his rants. It started out 2 weeks ago with him wearing a White Lives Matter shirt in Paris with Candace Owens. Mm-hmm. And AC and I touched on that issue in the last episode. But from there, he just went on a tour. I think he went on Fox first with Tucker Carlson. He ended up going on Drink Champs again. So we mentioned the first Drink Champs episode last week or 2 weeks ago. But he's gone on there again, and that just became incendiary. There were some Twitter rants that went on where basically he said, I'm sleepy, but I'm about to go to fuck off on these Jews. I'm coming for that ass.
DEFCON 3.
Yeah. So he put some veiled threats out to Jewish people. But in his recent rants, he's been claiming to be Jewish.
Mm-hmm.
And it sounds like beyond listening to, you know what I'm saying, conservative Christians, he's decided to start listening to Hebrew Israelites as well.
Oh.
He's Hebrew Israelites who probably wouldn't vote at all rather than vote for, you know, Christians.
Right.
So I don't know who he's been talking to, but his narrative has gotten really muddy. But he's been very much on the idea that he is Hebrew recently, and then he started coming for the members of the Jewish community in America. And as we know, you can't be anti-Semitic in this country. That's the third rail, you know.
Yeah.
And he's been fucking fried for it. So my question is, how do y'all feel about that?
Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to mention something about the DEFCON 3. That's kind of like a mild thing. That's like, you know, war is being talked about, and DEFCON 1 is mean war is imminent. So
that nigga said death. He didn't say death. He said death.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's didn't not carry
on. Didn't carry on because he don't know what the hell he's talking about. Second of all, you know, I don't. You know, but his every time he speaks, but lately it seems like his speech has become very venomous, especially with the attack on the Floyd family and the anti-Semitic statements he did this week. So it's just like, I don't know if he's, you know, vying for attention or want to get into the spotlight or whatever, but his words and his actions seem, you know, vile lately, as of late.
I know he said something about the Floyd family.
Mm-hmm.
What did he say? He said he was going off Candace Owens.
He was going off his Candace Owens quote unquote documentary about the George Floyd thing, where he said, you know, he was high and they didn't have his knee on his neck, they had his knee on his back, and you know, when he was saying I want my mama, he was saying he was calling for his girlfriend, not his actual mama, like all these. Like, fuck what the medical examiner said. Like, all these conspiracy theories, right, that, you know what I'm saying? Like, all this fake bullshit.
Yeah, he blamed it on the fentanyl.
Yeah, the fentanyl, yeah.
And not the fact that, you know, yes, fentanyl was probably a contributing factor. But had all he right. been on fentanyl alone and passed a fake 20 and he kept it moving, he probably had been cool.
Right.
So, go ahead, AC, you were saying?
No, I mean, to bring it back to what I think certain things he's saying are conversations that need to be had, but at the same time, he's making certain, like, it's fucked up because it's like he's ruining the conversation that needs to be had.
Yeah.
Right. Like, he's making shit a monolith, and no, you know, not all black people are monoliths, not all white, you know, like, everybody's not a monolith. So he's bringing up a conversation that needs to be had, but he's bringing it up for selfish reasons, and he's bringing it up inaccurately. Like, and it's real fucked up.
Yeah, inaccurately is very accurate.
Yeah, got it.
Ida, what you think?
I try not to listen to Kanye. I think one of the things I think that stands out to me with all of this goes back to, like, what he's being kind of persecuted for right now, or, like, what he's finally being held to the flame, or whatever that phrase is, because he talked about Jewish people, and that's, like, the big thing, like you said, that you can't do in this country, which is I just don't fully understand it still, why that's the one main protected group that you can't talk bad about, or even just mentioning in some situations. People think that you're saying something anti-Semitic. But yeah, I don't know. It's just interesting that that's now what has made people be like, okay, we got to pull out these sponsorships. We got to not have him be our management agent. We got to stop stocking these things in our stores. We got to take those designs from him and use them and sell them for $20 instead of for $5,000, whatever. It's just, why was it not bad when he was talking shit about black people?
Exactly. That's what I've been on all week. Yeah. Like, he can tap dance all over black people. Mm-hmm. He can talk shit about any race he want to talk to. You know what I'm saying? Anybody he want to talk about. But when he's anti-Semitic, now all of a sudden we pull in the cord.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it was so quick. It was so total too. It was like,
yeah, it was. It was like, oh no, let's all pull out. I'm like,
Yeah.
But do you think, I got a question though. Do you think that like, when I say, well, so when I revert back to what I said about conversations that need to be had, like, two sides to every coin, let me play devil's advocate real quick. Do you think the issue is the fact that, not necessarily because Jews control everything, but because the structure that their community has versus the structure that the black community has or other groups has? Because think about when other groups want to get shit done, they get it done. We're right. Talking about LGBTQ, Jewish, like whatever. Like, when they want to get certain shit done, they get certain shit done. Mm-hmm. So I guess that's the conversation. But at the same time,
none of them other groups were ripped from their heritage.
Yeah. I hear what you're saying. I'm just playing devil's advocate. I mean, if you're Jewish, you can say you had to deal with the Holocaust. What I'm saying is, you're galvanizing one thing and separating everything else. Does that make sense? What I'm trying to get at here,
I don't know what you're trying to say, but I would say that the reaction to Kanye is exactly what the fuck Kanye was talking about. It proves his point. Mm-hmm. I mean, he talked about a lot of bullshit this week, mm-hmm. but he was on this Hebrew Israelite kick where he was a member of one of the 12 tribes. And, you know, I'm not saying he's wrong. But when I think it was what he said on Twitter, basically, I'm coming for y'all, DEFCON 3, whatever the fuck he said. And they was like, nope, we're not going for this. We're pulling the plug. And I'm like, why the fuck didn't we pull the plug 4 years ago when slavery was a choice?
Mm-hmm. Right. Then you go back to, why didn't black people pull the plug? Why didn't we galvanize around him like that for that statement?
Because black people don't have access to the plug.
No. And that was it.
And that's what Kanye been saying.
Saying it all, yeah.
I mean, so I watched something from Russell Simmons.
So no black people went to his concerts. No black people bought his music. No black people entertained anything that this.
Well, it's not even about buying the stuff, though. Like, you got to think about what is it that made Kanye suddenly right now turn around and start suddenly like, oh, I'm backtracking, I'm apologizing. It was the $1 billion deals. It was the big celebrity athletes. I don't know who these basketball players were. I think they were basketball, but not being
Jaylen Brown was one. Just played in the NBA Finals last year.
From the Aaron Donald.
Like, it's not just the concert.
Aaron Donald, the best defensive player.
When he was talking
bad
about black people, nobody was like, we're going to not sponsor his concert. We're not going to, if he has a drink, we're not going to do his drinks anymore. We're not going to host his ugly-ass fashion shows. Like, nobody said any of that stuff before. But now, all of a sudden, it's like, we got to cut ties with him. We got to make sure that he doesn't have access to Twitter, access to YouTube, access to, I think there's another platform that he got
Instagram.
It's like, yeah, none of that stuff happened before. So I get what you're saying, AC, like the black community didn't like blacklist him, but I think it's bigger than just black people getting together, because black people don't have.
Well, I mean, even all these people that empower him, though, like, or I say empower him, or all these people, like, we just said a player who played in the NBA Finals that his company represents, and a player who won the Super Bowl, an MVP type player of the Super Bowl,
yeah,
who won the Super Bowl last year. They just connected from him. When he said that shit, they were still connected to him. They could have disconnected from him then. Why didn't they do it then?
Is what I'm asking.
That's what I'm saying.
And I think one of the athletes had said something like, you know, I've talked about how I don't like what he's saying, but now I feel like I got to actually put my, like, make sure that my business deals match my personal deals or something like that. So I don't know why they didn't feel that they needed to match before. I think that another big thing is, I think in the years since he was talking about slavery as a choice, social media has continued to boom and grow even more. So I don't know if that has a thing to do with it, where people are able to see even more and more and more everything Kanye says this crazy. I don't know. I don't know what it is, but it worked this time. So.
Yeah, and I think it worked because he fucked with the wrong one. You know what he did? He fucked around.
He done found out.
Real quick. Because he was so awesome. I can say what the fuck I want to say, and Adidas ain't going to cut me.
Mm-hmm.
Adidas was like, holla.
2 hours later.
You thought.
He fucked around and found out.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, it just, we had an episode on this shit a little over a year ago, a year and a half ago, I think, called Anti-Melanated.
Yes.
This is anti-melanation.
At its core.
Black man says something wild about the Jews. But he can say wild shit about every other fucking group. But when he says something about the Jews, we're going to take the vast majority of this nigga's net worth away from him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, out of you in a school, this reminds me of, like, a kid that's been allowed to be a pain in the ass and administration doesn't do anything about it forever. What's going to happen to that kid? After a whole school year of just doing whatever the fuck they want to do.
They're going to stay at it.
They're going to get worse. We're
going to find out the next year.
Yeah, they're going to get worse and worse and worse. And then now we upset that he's like this. Well, we made this monster.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. I don't go for a lot of Kanye shit. But I don't dismiss him as purely crazy. You know?
I think he's very strategic in what he's doing, and I think the mental health things that he has may play a part in it, but I think he knows what the fuck he's doing.
Well, which brings me back to that point when I was talking about Skechers, like him showing up to Skechers, that was premeditated.
Mm-hmm.
Skechers, I want to say Skechers has a Jewish owner. Don't quote me on that, but I think I heard that somewhere. Mm-hmm. You show up to another Jewish company after the statements you've made about the Jewish community with cameras, you what you're doing is intentional. Mm. Let's not mistake that.
Yeah. I don't know. I'll tell you what, he wanna be friends now. Let's take a look at some of that.
You know why I apologize, why I say I'm sorry to the Jewish people that I hurt? It's not about, like I said, I'm not gonna hold this apology hostage, right? It's obviously it's about God, but God is everything, right? So what's the point of even having language and being, you can't engineer if you say God, 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 right? It's like, it's God asks us to be judgmental so that you become, if you're a doctor, right? It's your judgment that saves grandma, right? Mm-hmm. And God puts that in this. Like, we have God inside us. We're a piece of God also, right? So I'm going to go specific to a person. That story about Da Vinci alone is enough of a reason for me to give a sincere apology to the Jewish people, because I do believe that there's a Da Vinci code inside of all of my misspellings and scribbles right here that God wants me to get to the world. And when I'm in my way, if God has set something on me, when I'm in my way, I'm in God's way. Now, I can point at other people and say, hey, you guys are in God's way because you're not listening to me. But if I'm in my way, I'm not listening to God. And for me to be a philosopher and a leader, or whatever other language, to listen to God.
Bro,
I'm sorry. This nigga went to the Herschel Walker School of Speech.
I was about to say it, dog. That nigga sounds like Herschel Walker found Jesus.
Like, what the fuck? I didn't understand a word that motherfucker was saying. Was it an apology or a speech?
That nigga did not talk in a circle. That nigga talked in a triangle.
He had them sharp ass corners, huh?
What the fuck? He was everywhere.
I don't know. I just know
that apology was sincere.
It was sincere because he got his ass handed. Because I was talking to Ada. What this nigga loves to do, is talk about how rich he is and how he's like the modern day Mansa Musa. He got more money than the black man ever. And like say, I'm not taking advice from anybody who ain't got no more money than me.
Right.
But all then Adidas and Balenciaga and everybody on fucking earth showed him how much money he really had. Your money's not that long, sir.
Your arms too short to box with guys.
So then now he's humble.
Yeah, I'm very humble.
Nigga, how do you lose $1 billion in 2 weeks?
Nigga, not a billion. He likes to let you know it's multi-billion, bro. I'm not a millionaire. I'm a multi, but get it right. I don't know.
He was.
So he lost multiple billions. Nigga, he was like overnight.
Yeah.
Maybe he will have learned to just shut the fuck up sometimes.
Why the fuck we ain't teach this nigga when he was talking about Rosa Parks?
Oh yeah,
but not Rosa Parks. When you were talking about Harriet Tubman.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying. Speaking of which, let's check this out. An oldie but goodie.
You feel that I'm feeling? Do you feel that I'm being free and I'm thinking free?
I actually don't think you're thinking anything. I think what you're doing right now is actually the absence of thought. And the reason why I feel like that. It's because, Kanye, you're entitled to your opinion. You're entitled to believe whatever you want. But there is fact and real world, real life consequence behind everything that you just said. And while you are making music and being an artist and living the life that you've earned by being a genius, the rest of us in society have to deal with these threats to our lives. We have to deal with the marginalization that has come from the 400 years of slavery that you said for our people was a choice. Frankly, I'm disappointed, I'm appalled, and brother, I am unbelievably hurt
by the fact that you have morphed into something, to me, that's not real.
Do you feel that I'm...
Why he didn't get canceled back then?
That's what I just said.
Honestly, if you think about all this shit that's been happening in the past 2-3 years about critical race theory and what should be taught in schools and what history is real and what history is not real, and no, we have to say that, like, we have to show both sides. I bet most of the people who have all these businesses that are canceling him right now might think slavery was a choice to damn selves, or might not give a shit about slavery. So why would we
got to tell both sides, why we can't tell both sides about the Jews?
Ooh, that's a good question. Why can't we tell both sides about the Jews?
I was listening to...
That's not America.
I was listening to Russell Simmons earlier today, mm-hmm. and he was, you know, he's been heavily involved with Jewish investors in a lot of his ventures. Mm-hmm. We know Rick Rubin was one of the guys who helped him start Def Jam. You know, he said he had Jewish investors in Fat Farm and the Rush Car, right, and several things other, you know, that he's done. And he's passed on those, you know, contributions to other people. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he was saying and reminded me that, you know, Jewish people basically owned all the things that WASP didn't want to own. Mm-hmm. Right. So they took on business ventures that WASP didn't want to do. So when it came to hip hop, they didn't want to do that. So the ones who had access to it were the Jews, and they were willing to work with us. They were willing to work with us during the civil rights movement. You know, we know we saw Bernie Sanders marching with Dr. King. Schwerner, Cheney, and Goodman were two Jews and a black man in Mississippi that were murdered trying to register voters in Freedom Summer. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, Jewish people have been available to black people to kind of reach down and help us up and then helped a Kanye, a Russell Williams, what the fuck is his name? Russell Simmons, I'm sorry. Simmons. To kind of get to, you know, a higher elevation to kind of reach down for the rest of us. But then there's also the story of NWA.
Yeah, Jerry Heller.
Yeah. And how, you know, saying there's been a lot of exploitation. I think one of the things that that Kanye was trying to say, and maybe not anything we played here today, but we can play nigga all over the radio. It can be all over your songs, you know what I'm saying? We can play you know what I'm saying? Women shaking their ass, and we can do, you know, all kinds of, murder is all over records, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
But none of that get canceled. But come for a Jew. Nigga, they shut this shit down quick, bro. That's so wild to me. This is wild.
Well, I mean, even if you say the word Jew wrong, they're coming for you, mm-hmm. you know, and it's just, to me, it's just so unfair that, you know, we get the short end of the stick, you know, we get looked over as if we're not even there.
Like we recognize hegemony, we recognize, you know what I'm saying, unfair treatment. We, you know, we talked about the African Holocaust, which has lasted 400 years. AC was quick to bring up, you know what I'm saying, their Holocaust. I mean, you go back, and I think Kanye even brought this up, the Hebrews in Egypt, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And so we share a common bond with them that we've been oppressed and we feel for them, and I think they felt for us and try to act in our stead, you know, in several cases. But I mean, I don't understand why it's not cool to say right is right and wrong is wrong. You know, if there's exploitation going on, why is that not cool to say?
Yeah.
Who is being exploited? That's the question. And that's what makes the difference.
Yeah, it's about power, isn't it? Power dynamic.
Yeah, it is about power.
Yeah.
We have less power than our Jewish counterparts, you know?
So when this episode doesn't come out,
because we've been canceled.
And then they send it to my bosses at the school board. We're like, anyway. He's already been mentioned, but we got some information on one of our favorite running backs trying to run back to the Senate, Mr. Herschel Walker. An unnamed woman alleges Herschel Walker pressured her into an abortion in 1993. This is not the first one we heard of. This is at least the second. Ida, you brought this story, didn't you?
Yeah, I think this is at least the second one that's come forward, the second woman that has come forward saying that he, in their hands, pretty much gave them money to go get an abortion. This woman, I believe, said that he waited in the car there with her. The other woman had said that she had a card with his signature. He was like, I'll know that woman. That other first woman was like, I'm your kid's mother, like of the kids that were born. Like, I have other kids with you. So who knows? This woman, they didn't, they had played her voice, but they didn't identify her name because she's smart enough to know that she doesn't want to be in the public eye that way. But yeah, he's still denying everything. He had a debate. Was that last week? Debate where he's still talking crazy?
Yeah, I think it was 2 weeks ago on Friday.
Yeah, when you two were, you and AC were on.
Yeah, we talked about it, but we didn't really know what the key thing was the little fake badge.
Oh my gosh.
So we were just kind of grasping at whatever we could find, but yeah, that was wild too. So it sounds like Herschel Walker earned his name. That nigga's Herschel Walker ass to the abortion clinic and made sure she go through with it.
Herschel Walker,
he is the abortion whisperer. I tell you that.
That's what I'm. Hey man, Herschel Walker ass to the clinic, bro. That's his new name.
Herschel Walker ass to the clinic.
That's pretty good.
That's fucked up.
So anyway, a woman who claims she was in a years-long romantic relationship with Herschel Walker says the Republican Senate nominee in Georgia pressured her into having an abortion in 1993. She announced at her press conference on Wednesday. The woman, referred to as Jane Doe to protect her identity, attended the press conference virtually with her lawyer, Gloria Allred, and read her statement. Her voice was heard, but her face was not shown. Doe says she decided to tell her story now to highlight what she said in Walker's hypocrisy. Yeah. He is publicly taking the position that he is about life and against abortion under any circumstances, when in fact he pressured me to have an abortion and personally ensured that it occurred by driving me to the clinic and paying for it, said Doe. At a campaign event in Georgia, prior to the press conference, Walker called the allegation a lie. I already told people this is a lie, and I'm not going to entertain, continue to carry a lie. But no, this thing can't talk.
Are you that's you're reading that? That's manuscript.
I'm trying to
somebody translating his words.
I'm trying to, yeah. I already told people this is a lie, and I'm not going to entertain, continue to carry a lie along. And I also want to let you know that I didn't kill JFK either.
Oh, wow.
That's pretty good.
Oh, shit.
How, God, that is the definition of being dumber by listening to somebody.
Yeah, let there you know, go. Just in case you want to know, man, you pinning everything on me. I ain't killed JFK neither.
Oh, it's like that scene. What's that scene at the end of Happy Gilmore? We are dumber.
For having listened to you.
For having listened to you.
Oh, shit.
I don't know, man.
Well, I mean, why is he still a candidate, man?
Because it's too late.
Yeah, it's not about why is he still a candidate. The real question is, why is he probably going to win the whole thing?
Well,
why does he even have a chance?
Yeah, the last time we looked, he was behind the polls.
Yeah.
But
it's still, I think it's more that people are still putting in money and trying to make sure that, like it should not be a close race at this point.
I think the more he opens his mouth, the more his points go down. It was like, Herschel Walker's running. We're going to vote for Herschel. Yeah, Georgia. But the more this nigga opens his mouth, the more motherfuckers watching him open their mouth. Like, what? No. This is too far. You're gone too far.
Yeah, I mean, I've definitely heard people, and I know it's the case, but they don't give a fuck if this nigga was a you know what I'm saying, aborting bitches with like a fucking fillet knife. Like, they don't give a shit about none of that. They
look for that R next to his name. He gonna win. That's
what the R. They want to control the Senate.
Oh, mm-hmm. Right, because that nigga's clearly gonna do whatever they say.
Exactly.
Yeah, man. He's a puppet. That's what he's there to do.
He's definitely going to be, what's his name's yes man? The one from
Mitch McConnell.
Lindsey Graham.
Oh, Lindsey Graham.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Lindsey Graham did a little video with him this week. His shit was kind of wild,
yes,
too.
Yes, he did.
Wow. He's like, you can call us racist, you can call us bigots, but this is the proof. We nominated Herschel Walker.
He was like, here's my puppet.
Exactly. That's what I was gonna say.
Here's my puppy. He's well trained. You want to pet him? Mm-hmm. He doesn't bite.
I'm gonna drink this glass of water. Watch his mouth move.
Right. It reminded me of the toy. I don't know if y'all all seen the toy.
Yeah.
That's that whole speech right there reminded me of the toy. In a sense.
Yeah. I can't be racist. Look at my black friend.
Yes. Look at my toy. I mean, friend.
Yeah.
So.
I know not what to say.
Oh, no. I want to hear his son talk about him again. I enjoyed that.
Yeah, that was brilliant.
I enjoyed that. Talk about him again.
We got about 2 weeks, man. Actually, probably about a week and a half.
Mm-hmm.
November 8th, man.
Yeah.
Georgia, y'all got to do what y'all supposed to do. Speaking of voting, Tim, what you do in Louisiana?
Mail-in vote. A highly contested race in Louisiana.
Is it highly contested?
Not really.
Okay.
It's not really. It's... It should be, but it's really a little bit more of a, like, show and flair, but it really is getting people out there to at least hear what others have to say. And one of the biggest, when I checked the polls the last time, and this was about a month ago, not quite a month ago. But and the race is between Senator Kennedy and the incumbent and Gary Chambers. And Gary has pulled up some, but he's still behind. It's like 45-32 or something like that.
Yeah.
Chambers. I'm sorry, not Chambers, Kennedy. So he's far behind, but he's like gaining because of his Twitter feeds. And I invite people to go out and check him out. Hear what he has to say. Hear some of the stuff that's going on in Louisiana that he wants to change and wants to fix a broken system. So,
yeah.
Mail-in ballot.
See, mail-in ballot, we're good. Good on you. Good on you. Speaking of Twitter, Elon Musk has completed his $44 billion deal to buy Twitter. A source familiar with the deal told CNN Thursday, putting the world's richest man in charge of one of the world's most influential social media platforms. Hmm. Musk fired CEO Parag Agrawal.
Yeah.
Agrawal and two other,
we'll go with it.
Yeah. And two other executives, according to two people familiar with the decision, Twitter declined to comment. They're going to be declining a whole bunch of niggas' comments in a minute.
he escorted them niggas out the building the first day. Like, yep.
Well, they actually said that now they're starting to see more racist tweets and all this stuff. I saw a bunch of people today posting that they reported people that normally would have got blocked, but now they're not getting blocked anymore. So people are wondering if that's like a change that he's already implementing into what you're allowed to say. Because his big thing was he wants free speech. So I guess he's letting...
Or, you know, one of those things, too, Donald Trump was suspended from there. So, you know, I'm pretty sure he's going to let that motherfucker back on there to run wild.
So it's kind
of
easy.
That's part of it. I think one of the people he fired, like, was one of the people that had something to do with Donald Trump being suspended.
Yeah, I saw that.
Is Elon on that bullshit?
I don't know what he believes.
Motherfuckers about free speech, so you're going to have motherfuckers on there getting loose.
Tongues just in the wind.
I don't know. Free speech is important, but that's a private platform. But they have taken their private platform and opened it up to the public. But I still believe that, you know, willfully misleading people is wild as fuck.
Mm-hmm.
And probably should not be permitted. So does that mean Ye gets back on?
Probably.
He's on. Oh, yeah. His suspension has been lifted.
From Twitter?
Yes.
Well, how long was the suspension supposed to be?
Oh, I don't know, but... I just read that Elon Musk didn't have anything to do with his suspension being lifted. But, yeah, it's lifted.
Well, I'm sure the firing of the people who had control over all that shit had something to do with it. So he probably affected it indirectly.
Yes. I second that.
So is he back on Twitter wild the fuck out, or is he still on the apology tour trying to make friends?
I haven't seen the latest tweets, but my guess is he's about to wild the fuck out DEFCON 3.
He might even
do DEFCON 5.
I don't know, them billions might take his ass back to Orange.
Well,
calm down, nigga. You go back to yellow, we might give you a couple mil back.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of DEFCON 5 or 10 or whatever is the most mild, kidnapping investigation raises new questions about reports of missing black women.
Oh, shit.
Why I get an oh, shit?
Because... It gives the city a black eye that they have this issue about missing black women, and they seem to not do anything about it.
I don't know, man. I was reading the article. It said y'all niggas might have a serial killer this killing black woman and nobody gives a fuck.
Yeah. Yeah. There was a report about this guy that's in Excelsior Springs that are taking women out of Kansas City and possibly killing them.
Yeah, that's what this story is about.
Yeah, we're making Dahmer burgers or what?
Something like that. But yeah, I just across that about the Excelsior Springs serial killer.
Something like that. You heard what I said, right?
You said Dahmer burger. You said the making them Dahmer burgers, something like that. I don't know if he's eating them or what. But yeah, he is the taker or alleged taker of black women and killing them.
Dude, it said like maybe I read it wrong, but it said like in a week 4 women went missing. Like in a week.
I think that's what I heard. I didn't read.
And then they were like the police were like, no, nothing was founded or everything was unfounded. Like they don't give a fuck. Like they didn't even look into it.
Right.
For real.
Kansas City, Missouri Police Department called these reports, quote, unfounded, but a horrific discovery is now raising new questions. Last Friday, police in the nearby city of Excelsior Springs arrested a white man on multiple charges, and a 22-year-old black woman said that she had escaped his basement after being held captive for weeks.
Yeah. I think she escaped half-clothed, or, you know, her clothes were ripped or whatever. Torn. I think that was one of the highlights of that story.
So the suspect
and she ran to a neighbor's house or something like that.
Yeah.
To call the police.
The suspect is Timothy Hazlett Jr.
Oh.
So we just made him famous.
Yeah.
Oh. I figured you niggas might want to know that there's a crazy motherfucker in your backyard.
You know, we know now.
So, Ida, you might want to stay away from the city for a while.
Just a little bit.
Might be safer than that.
Women just need to stay strapped. I guess, is open carry in Missouri, or you just don't need a permit? They need to get on that.
I'm pretty sure we've been on that. I think we
got Texas in the open carry.
Yeah. So, you stay on that side of the state and dodge bullets at school. Don't come over here because you might get kidnapped and thrown in the basement.
Yeah.
Bam.
You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
That's some fucked up bullshit. I don't know what to say about it. We can move on to the next story, though. Speaking of women and crime, we got a woman who told police she was too good looking to be arrested and is now accused of killing her mother.
Oh,
fuck. That's a wild turn.
Oh.
That's a wild turn.
Oh.
Las Vegas. A 28-year-old woman who previously told police she was too good looking to be arrested is now accused of killing her mother. Hen Bustami allegedly killed her 62-year-old mother Wednesday morning, Las Vegas Metro Police said. Officers began looking for her, for the daughter, after finding the mother's body, Lieutenant David Valenta said. California Highway Patrol took Bustami into custody in Barstow, California around 5 a.m. So she got on the road.
Right, she rolled out.
Yeah. Police said in August they arrested Bustami for reportedly skipping out on a restaurant tab and violating airport rules at Harry Reid International Airport. Bustami told officers at the time that she was under arrest because she was so good looking, an arrest report said. Soon after, officers working D gates were notified by TSA that a female matching that description was observed sleeping near the security checkpoint, hindering their operations, the report said. Officers later found Bustami in the baggage claim area where she was belligerent with officers, saying she was being harassed because cops had never seen anyone as pretty as her.
Wow. My nigga, she stuck her head in a tiger when she was young.
She probably did. No, bro. She's not white, though.
No, oh, yeah? She's not white. I just seen a picture of her.
No, she may be mixed.
Hmm. Is her statement valid?
I would even...
She can definitely get clapped in irons. I don't know if that's for the rest or...
She's colored, though. She's definitely colored.
Yeah. So, I don't know. Police later learned of a warrant from Las Vegas Municipal Court for Basami's arrest. Records show she faced a battery charge from June. She was booked into a Clark County Detention Center and later released. She was being held... at a San Bernardino County jail on a fugitive of justice charge related to the killing. A court appearance has not been scheduled as of Wednesday night. Bustami will be brought back to Nevada to face murder charges, police said. So.
Wow.
Maybe she was too cute to be arrested for sleeping in the terminal or some shit. I don't know.
Hell.
But not cute enough to get away for killing her mom. Yeah?
I don't think anybody's that cute that is that they can't be arrested. So
Ashanti might have something to say about that.
Good segue.
Yes, perfect.
We got a tweet here from Ashley Viola. Ashanti was essentially blacklisted by Irv Gotti after deciding that she no longer wanted to continue their sexual relationship. Makes me think how many other female artists who suddenly disappeared were completely shut out of the industry by controlling manipulative men. Ada, you brought that to us, right?
Yeah, I don't know too much about it. I just saw that tweet earlier, I think today. It made me curious about, there's been a lot of women in the past that have been pretty big or seem pretty big, like Ashanti was. She was all over the place, and then all of a sudden she wasn't. So I wonder if that's something, if you weren't sleeping with the right person or decided you didn't want to sleep anymore with that same person, they were just, like, blacklisted.
Is Irv Gotti Jewish?
I don't know.
Yeah.
He's Italian.
Is he Italian? I don't know. He's black, but
I don't know. But the way that nigga went off on drink camps makes that seem like a totally valid statement.
Hey, I tell you what, I look at Ashanti and I want a black baller too. Playing the part of Roger on the show today
Oh, shit.
Anyway, I don't know. Yeah, that's really fucked up. And, yeah, Ashanti was, like, blowing up, and then she just kind of disappeared. Yeah, so, I mean.
Yeah, just out of the limelight. I mean, don't get me wrong. She still looks good. Oh, my God.
Well, yeah, I mean, and I went down that road too, but the idea was that, yeah, obviously it wasn't that, she had fallen off appearance-wise. I mean, she was I ain't saying she was like Whitney Houston or Aretha or something like that, but she could sing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, I felt like she was part of a...
No, nigga, she was part of a machine that was a hit maker.
That's what I was about to say next.
Her voice was it from like fucking 99 to like 2001, 2002. You couldn't turn on the radio and not hear her voice.
Hear her voice, mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, so I mean, some fucked up shit.
Yeah, it was.
Speaking of blackballed, Dusty Baker has something to say. There is a World Series game, or World Series going on, and unfortunately, AC's team lost game one. Astros lost 6-5 to the Phillies in game one. But Dusty Baker, a black manager who I'm rooting for, I've been rooting for the last 20-some-odd years since he was a Barry Bonds manager in San Francisco in the 2002 World Series. So the 2022 World Series, he's back, and he is the only American black face there.
Wow. Which is crazy.
Crazy. You know.
So, like, the other brown people are Dominican or Cuban or something?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep.
So there's other brown faces, but they're not native. And so I think we laughed at a thing I do in an earlier episode. I don't remember how long ago it was, but I kind of go around Major League Baseball and I make an all nigga team.
Yeah.
And because it's hard to do. Like, when we were kids, the best players in baseball were black. Barry Bonds, Ken Griffey.
Yep.
You might have had a Doc Gooden, Daryl Strawberry, I'm trying to think of my man who was the pitcher for the A's when they won.
Oh, shit.
Stewart. I can't think of his first name.
Yeah, but you had your Tony Gwynn's and Bobby Bonilla's and all them.
All them people, yeah. You had people, you could go around the diamond and you could find somebody who was, you know, more than somebody, there was a bunch of somebodies. We talked in one of those episodes, maybe the same episode, where Pittsburgh looked up one day in the 70s and every single player on the field was an African-American.
Yep. Can't even imagine that right now.
Yeah, it won't happen.
Nope.
So, like I said, I kind of go around the diamond every year and figure out who's the best black player at every... I think it was when Aaron Judge was going for 62.
Yep.
But I go around the diamond every year and see who would be the all-star of black players. And that's getting increasingly hard as the years go on because U.S.-born black players are becoming a rarity, you know.
Yeah. Nope.
They're playing basketball and football mostly.
Yeah. I don't know.
Are there any black coaches along with this Houston guy?
Say again.
In the MLB?
What was the question?
Are there any other black coaches along with the Houston coach?
Managers.
Manager. Okay.
There have been others, but currently, I can't. I really can't call it right now.
Is the dude in L.A. black, or he's not? He's not black.
Yes, yes, he is. Old buddy who stole the base in 2004 to help them start the comeback, to help the Red Sox start the comeback against the Yankees down 3-0.
Yeah, I can't think of his name, though.
Dave Roberts.
Yep, that's it.
Dave Roberts is at least mixed, yeah. Yeah. So that's two. And he coached for a good team and has won a World Series as a player and a manager. I can't think of another one, though.
I couldn't off the top of my head either.
Yeah. I mean, it's wild shit. My backyard is the place where the old stadium in Kansas City used to be, where the Monarchs used to be, where Jackie Robinson used to play. And so, you know, I grew up, in history class. Part of the reason why I'm a historian is because I used to look up shit about the Kansas City Monarchs and black baseball players and, you know, kind of wondered about the mythology of all that. And I don't know. It's becoming a thing of the past.
Yeah, that used to be a, you know, we used to play baseball.
We did.
We used to play baseball, like the way that, you know, kids are crazy about basketball players and football players. Little black kids used to be like that about baseball players.
We used to play quote unquote slow pitch softball in recess.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? We would blur the lines between slow pitch and fast pitch. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, we would do this shit in fucking at recess. They don't even play kickball no more.
Right. I mean, that was the concept of baseball.
Yeah. Oh, we used to love kickball. Kickball was every fucking game, and they don't do nothing like baseball anymore.
Nope.
And I don't know. I don't know.
Well, baseball kind of low-key baseball has shifted into, in my opinion, it's shifted into like a specialized sport. So it's almost shifted into the kids that play baseball are usually the parents play golf and shit like that. You know what I'm saying?
It has become a sport because it's like you said, it's so specialized. A lot of people claim that to be the hardest thing to do is to hit a moving fastball, you know, hit a round ball with a round bat that's, you know, moving at such a velocity and has curve and that type of shit. And
shit is hard.
And so you kind of, they feel like you almost got to do that to the exclusion of all other sports and be doing that shit year round and see so many pitches and that type of thing. And get on travel teams. And that comes with, you know what I'm saying, having to have specialized bats and gear and, you know, gloves and all that type of stuff. And it prices, you know, a lot of black people out of the market.
Yep.
So I live very close to the Negro League Baseball Museum, which is a hop skip from the Urban Youth Academy in Kansas City, another royal sponsor. And they give access to the fields there to, you know, high schools such as my own, which are highly, you know, urban, black. So there's been efforts to try to get black people back into baseball. There's the RBI League, which stands for Reviving Baseball in the Inner City.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what's going to take. I really don't know what's going to take. I guess black people have just decided that they don't like baseball.
There's baseball. Baseball seems like also one of those sports where there's no immediate payoff for your efforts, if that makes sense. Like, you know, like you play football, you get drafted high, you're going to come out and you're going to see the fruits of that benefit. College, you can leave early. If you play basketball, you can immediately see those fruits of that. But in baseball, it doesn't really work like that for the most part. Like, yeah. You got to serve. It's still like a tradition in where, I mean, unless you're just a fucking stud, you still got to serve your time.
But you got to be a stud in the NBA to do that shit, too.
True. True. But it's more visible, I guess.
It is more visible. But why?
Yeah, that's another conversation.
Yeah, I think it's a thing that goes back to, like, youth in sports and what you can do. And, like, the fact that, like, kids today don't really play outside. But if you do, you're going to see, you can have one other person, or you by yourself, and you can play basketball. You could have one other person with you, and you could be tossing the football and practicing tackles and practicing blocking people. But for baseball, you got to have, like, a lot of people. Or at least, I mean, you can practice your pitching. You can practice batting a little bit, but it's not as easy to get out and do it.
I call bullshit. I used to go back in the backyard and play catch. We would definitely go try to strike each other out.
But you got to think about,
I remember,
like,
I broke several
today,
windows that way.
Kids today specialize, or kids, I don't want to say specialize, but kids today start young and then are like, oh, I'm 5, I'm going to only do basketball, and I'm going to play basketball until I graduate, and then I'm going to go to the NBA, and I know this when I'm 5. I don't feel like kids today really do baseball that way, or even T-ball. Like, I don't feel like I see T-ball games with little kids the way I used to when I was younger. Or, like, even other, like, I don't see really baseball that much. I still see soccer a lot. I see football games a little bit, but I don't really see baseball as much.
I guarantee you it happens. It may not happen in the black community.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's what I think the big part of it is like, but why? I don't know why, what the why is behind that. I think just the celebrities. Like, I mean, I am not a big baseball fan, but I can guarantee you when I was a kid, I knew Ozzie Smith and mm-hmm. Willie McGee and, like, all these black people who played for the Cardinals. I don't know a single Cardinal player right now.
Is it the way Major League Baseball markets itself?
I don't know if they. I don't think they do.
I think it may be too slow to the eye, to the blind eye. It may be too slow of a game for some to equip themselves to. Like all these other sports are equipping themselves to score all these points and you know, keep people entertained and keep people watching, because ultimately, you know, offense puts people in the seats and, you know, defense wins. But, you know, all the rules are bent in all these other sports to, you know, allow for all this high scoring, whereas baseball is a very methodical, you know, paced game.
You know what? But I think it's become that way because of all the sabermetricians and all type of shit. I think when she's talking about with the Ozzie Smith and the baseball that I grew up watching and the baseball that was going on in bandstands, you know, that Satchel Paige was playing in and, you know, young Jackie Robinson, niggas stole bases and they created runs and they moved runners. You know what I'm saying? There was shit going on. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And right now they don't steal bases. They sit back and they strike out a shit ton and they wait for the 3-run home run. You know what I'm saying?
True.
And it's station to station. It may be more efficient. I don't know. That's what they claim. But it's probably not as entertaining.
No, it's definitely not. And, you know, like, these motherfuckers can barely watch a 30-minute TV show. So without picking up an iPad or doing something or diverting their attention to somewhere else. So to actually watch a 9-inning baseball game.
But white kids do the shit, though.
Huh?
White kids be on the same iPad and they be up playing baseball.
True.
It's got to be deeper than that, man. I'm not putting it on the fucking iPad, bro.
I think it's the celebrity side. It's the celebrity side. It's the attention span side. It's the, you can, in any given moment in a football game, any given play in a football game, you can see some type of action, whether it's the offense, defense, referee running and getting out of the way. Football's like that. Basketball's like that. Any given play. Baseball, I mean, I haven't watched a baseball game in probably like 30-something years, but still, is not that much happening in a given moment. So I feel like kids with attention spans are like, oh, no, I want to do something where people are going to see me and they're going to know that I'm tackling somebody or I blocked this person or I did this. With baseball, it's less excitement as frequently as other sports, I think. Even soccer, I feel like you might have, like, more plays that are a little more exciting.
But,
I don't know.
But white people still do it.
Yeah.
And white people get into it. I'm not buying that argument. I understand that a lot of people make that argument.
I actually would fight you on that too a little bit, because I feel like baseball numbers have dropped for youth in general. I don't think it's a white and black thing. I think there's fewer black people who are doing it. And this is just anecdotal, but I feel like there's a lot more Latino people who are coming into baseball than white people as a percentage, than white or black people. Percentages compared to earlier years.
I definitely think the Latin and Asian influence has grown in the sport.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, white people, just because you used to have all the motherfuckers back when, you know, Babe Ruth was playing, has gone down in percentage. Yeah. I hear that too. I
honestly think you're overthinking it, bro. I think it's just not interesting to people. I just think it's not
like people,
if you poll the average, if you poll the average out of 10 people, if you poll them about baseball, most motherfuckers would be like, I'm not watching a full baseball game.
I hear that, but I think that's probably because it's been marketed poorly.
But how would you market differently, I guess, is the question. Like, what
shit,
would you do?
Aaron Judge is a black man who just broke the American League record for home runs. Why is he not on every fucking screen like LeBron?
That, I think, is a big thing. And that's, like, I only learned about that from you.
Yeah.
Granted, I don't watch a lot of sports. But I think even with that, that's one guy on one team who's going to be hitting maybe a home run a game. I guess maybe he's hitting more than that.
There is a Japanese dude who is a pitcher. He's one of the best pitchers in the damn game. And he's one of the best hitters in the game ever.
Yeah, he's a freak.
In one body. He's a fucking.
Yeah,
he's putting up numbers that even Babe Ruth was not aware it could happen.
Mm-hmm.
And he should be fucking plastered everywhere.
I agree, but that's one dude on one team with.
There's two dudes on that team. There's fucking. If you want me to name every like stud in the game, there's more than one dude that's doing these things.
Baseball's an old sport though, so you do have an old vanguard in baseball that you don't have in the other sports. Would you say that?
What do you mean?
Like older baseball seems more rooted in tradition than the other sports.
It is.
It is.
So because it's rooted in that tradition, do you think that transfers or translates into the promotion of the game? And they want to promote the game a certain way, therefore they won't reach for the fans the way the other sports are willing to reach for the fans?
And I think that's what I'm saying is the problem.
You could be spot on there.
Yeah, I'm saying to you that they have been stubborn in the way that they talk about the sport, and they have not promoted it to the young eyes, especially young African American eyes, the way that other sports have. You know,
they feel like they're America's pastime. They don't have to. Meanwhile, football has surpassed that.
I was gonna say it's been a long time since I feel like they could say baseball is as American as apple pie. I feel like even soccer is more.
It's
soccer than baseball.
I think it's straight up football.
Who eating apple pie?
Oh yeah, I definitely think it's football now. Football. Yeah, I'd say football more than basketball even.
Yep.
Well, basketball used to be number three on that list.
Mm-hmm.
And that's true. And it still may be. It's not number three among Black people.
I would say it's two, man.
You don't think it's number one?
Football's number one, bro.
Well, you're not biased at all, are you?
No, I'm just, I really could give a fuck about pro football, but I really think football, like, it annoys me, actually, the way motherfuckers talk about professional teams, but honestly, I really think football is, like, the number one sport in the country, bro. I don't see it now.
No, I know that it's the number one sport in the country. I'm asking about among Black youth.
Football.
I would probably still say football.
Football too, only basketball. Because more people can do football than basketball. Like on a team, you can have more people playing on a team than you can with basketball.
But as you said before, there's less prohibitions against playing basketball. You can go play one on one.
Yeah.
Nobody's playing one on one football.
No, but like if you look at teams though, like team sports. The football teams at most schools are going to have some good kids, some kids who ain't shit. I mean, every sport's like that, but, like, you could be not the greatest football player and still make the football team and still be excited and still get out there and still, like, do all that stuff that football players do. I feel like, I don't know, I just feel football is more exciting for kids than baseball.
I don't know. I've been in schools for the last 20-some-odd years, and the argument went from, Jordan versus Kobe, to Kobe versus LeBron, to LeBron versus Jordan.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been hearing that shit all the time for years. I don't know. But all of it is pointing to the fact that baseball is dying in the African-American community. And I really kind of find that depressing.
So, that's unfortunate.
Yeah.
Yep.
A little less depressing. Y'all cannot watch this with me, but how many of y'all seen this this young lady that was rocking out?
I have. I've seen it.
Hey, have you seen it?
I have not seen it, sir.
Do you have the link in the chat group?
What's the name of it?
It's the last thing I put up. I think I put it up under the Brothers Breaking Bread account. But we got a young lady that's rocking out. I'm just going to let it play.
All right, pull your hatchets out.
Oh, wow. Thank you, Adam.
Yes. Oh, my God. Every time it gets me, every time. I'm like, dude, what is wrong with you?
Oh, you're so lucky.
Oh, so we have a young lady who's moshing out to some song about murder, and she had picked up a knife out the kitchen and used it like a hatchet in her dance and went upside the fucking side of her head.
And left oh, my God. And sliced that bitch open.
Sliced that bitch the fuck open.
Wow.
Oh, shit. Well, she got her forehead and her nose, didn't she?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't even see the nose.
Oh, yeah, she opened her shit up. She opened her
shit
up.
Oh, yeah, she opened her nose, too.
All right, pull your hatchets out.
Bro, do you know how close she was to her eye?
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. What's the call? Call it.
I don't know. Can this be two things can be true?
What is it?
Can this be a stay in your lane? Because you're going to fuck around and find out.
Yeah, I hear you. But I want a basketball. I want a football call. Something. I want a call.
Bitch, that is a fucking that's a flag for the wrong equipment.
I call it a face mask.
Face mask?
Yeah, face mask.
I like it. Face mask.
Personal foul, 15 yards.
Literal hands to the face.
Yourself. She personally did it to herself. Nice.
Clipping. I call it clipping.
Clipping.
She clipped the shit out of her nose.
illegal cut block.
There you go. Yeah. Chop block.
Cut block.
Oh man.
Illegal hands to the face. I don't know. That's some wild shit. I don't know what kids doing these days.
Why are they doing that?
Nigga, that's what happens when you stick your head in tigers when you're a child.
That's what it is.
What the fuck happens?
That might be the episode title, Sticking Your Head in Tigers.
Just saying, man. The theory proved to be true.
The lessons we learned. I don't know. So, good people, the tabs, they have been tabulated. Anybody got anything they want to add?
Well, first off, it's great to be back in Kansas City amongst family, friends, and everything. And I'm looking forward to more evenings shared with my brothers.
Straight up. Straight up. Anybody else?
Man, it was good to see y'all. It was good to, finally meet up with 10 in person. No matter how we got there, my nigga.
Yes, we did. Yes, we did.
So, I left feeling good. And, hey, Joe, I've been listening to that damn Punching the Clock all week, nigga.
Punching the Clock? What are you talking about?
J. Cole.
Which one was that?
The one after Applying Pressure.
Oh, yeah, the song after that, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, bro, I don't know what you be doing, but you be sleeping, man. You be sleeping.
Nah, it took me through some workouts this week, boy, big time.
Yeah, yeah, so I'm glad you getting caught up. You getting caught up on that Pusha T again?
Nah, nigga, I'm on this new West Side Gun that just dropped today. You need to check that out.
I do.
He got a song with Black Star.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, I heard a little bit of it.
I think that track I sent you with Ghostface and Ray is crazy.
I haven't had a chance to check it out. We were doing parent-teacher conferences today, just like Ida was, so I was kind of busy and then I had a game to call.
Yeah, put that on your mind when you get a chance. That shit is crazy.
I'm gonna do it. So, well, we went around everybody else said, Ida, what you got?
I will say this. So about, I'll say it was about 2007, whatever the year was that the St. Louis Cardinal or the St. Louis Busch Stadium hosted the MLB All-Star Game, I wrote an essay. Mm-hmm. And I posted it online. It was all about my dislike of baseball. And I feel like it's come back around to that. And I feel that eventually, I'm going to make a prediction that I would say by like, what is this, 2022? Mm-hmm. By 2040, I don't think there'll be a single black person in the MLB. Maybe one.
Wow.
I think baseball is just, it's black people just don't do it as much. And I could see it becoming like no black people are in it. It's American born, I'll say. I'll keep it with that.
So in 18 years, I'm pretty sure there's a rookie right now that's going to last 20 years. I don't know, though.
I'll do a little research. I'll look at some what do you call it, NCAA teams, see what they're looking like. Do people go to baseball from NCAA? I don't even know how that works in MLB.
So baseball is most people will go, I don't know if somebody knows. Some of your best ones still go from high school in the draft. Mm-hmm. You know, Bryce Harper is in this World Series, and he came straight out of high school. Matter of fact, he left early. He went went to junior college like when he was 16, so he could do a year there and then get drafted because he didn't want to wait till the senior year of high school. He wanted to leave before senior year of high school, so he took dual credit at a junior college because there's like three ways to get drafted, maybe four ways to get drafted. So out of high school, you can do a year in junior college. You can go to a four-year school and serve three of them, or you can do all 4 years. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And so he decided, I'm going to go to a junior college for a year, but I'm going to do it after my sophomore year. Serve my junior year of high school at the junior college and get drafted while I'm still 16.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's also just insane that they let somebody who's that young start making all that money and be around grown-ass men.
They do it in tennis.
Yeah.
That's true.
But I feel like in tennis, it's more of an individual thing. So you're not going to be a 16-year-old surrounded by 20-something and 30-something-year-old men who are doing things that a 16-year-old boy probably shouldn't be around.
Well, he wasn't like that immediately anyway. They go to the minor leagues.
Okay.
Yeah, so he didn't go immediately to the major leagues. He went to the minor leagues.
I still think that they probably do even more outlandish shit on the – when they're not in games.
Man, he was also the star child. I'm sure he had somebody who was, you know, his little chauffeur while he was there. But so
interesting.
Yeah, I don't know. I know that. Let me say this: the MLB draft this year had a lot of black former athletes' kids going the first like four or five picks.
Okay.
So
maybe it started something different.
Maybe.
Hey, did Trout come out like that too? I know him and Bryce Harper came out the same year. Did he come out early like that too?
No, I don't think he did the wild shit that Harper did. Because Harper was supposed to be like the golden child. He was like the LeBron of baseball.
I remember it was supposed to be like him and Mike Trout was supposed to be like LeBron and Mel.
No, Mike Trout wasn't nearly that lauded like out of high school. Now, when he got to the majors, he was killing from the jump. He was on some Pujols shit where, you know what I'm saying, he kind of came out of nowhere. You know, Albert Pujols came out of Kansas City. He's from, like, the Dominican, but he went to school at Fort Osage High School in Kansas, in Independence, Missouri. And he did a year at the junior college around here, I think Maple Woods. And then he got drafted, but he didn't get drafted until, like, something stupid, like the seventh round, maybe been longer than that. And so Mike Trout was not like a number one overall pick like Bryce Harper was. He was I have to look it up, but I don't think he was a first round pick. And he just kind of caught fire. And when he got to the majors, yeah, he was doing it from the very beginning. But they wouldn't talk about him out of high school like that. So.
I don't know, man. It's just kind of a hit or miss thing with that. So I don't know. We gonna see. We gonna test Ida's theory. And in 18 years, I'm gonna call you up, Ida, and be like, "I told you."
I'll be like, "I told you." I'll even stretch it to say by 2050, and I'll say that by 2040, I guarantee that probably by that year, any World Series game will not have an American-born black player in it. In the World Series.
Wow.
Damn. So they're going to start going to, like, teams that are not that great. Unless we start seeing, like you said, these young people coming out, former athletes, kids that are super athletic and well-known name, sticking with the game.
Hey, in that year, we might be playing the Monstars, nigga.
Hey, play for your race. Play for your civilization.
Right.
I don't know.
Anyway, yeah. I brought up something new. I didn't mean to. But
nah, you're good. You're good. We out here breaking bread.
Yes,
that's how the bread crumbles. So, for Lady Lavender, 10 meters and Slim AC, we miss Donnie Bosco and Zebulon and Kim. And all the rest of the Brothers Breaking Bread crew. We're gonna sign off and remind folks, never forget to break bread with your brothers and sisters. We out. I gotta pull these fucking these Marshall these fucking Marshall Kanye's.
Oh, those shoes.
Oh, yeah.
That's hilarious to me.
Any of you guys own any of his shoes?
Not us. It's a black guy.
No. I'm not. I can't see myself paying $500 for a weirdly designed pair of Crocs.
Yeah. You don't have to now.
I know, they're $20.
Yeah.
Oh man, that's so terrible. My girlfriend's son has a pair of the slippers, dude. Like the sandals, them shits was $300.
That's so ridiculous. Those foam things.
Yeah, they were like
$300. Like an alien or something.
That's so wild.
Yeah, they look like cartoon shoes, like shit or something. George Jess and shit.
There it is.
In the books.
It's in the books. Hour 56 on that one.
Oh, not bad. Imagine, well, maybe next time you go up there, AC, I want to see the facilities. I'm not going to get in there if I just go by myself. They'd be like, who the fuck are you?
Hey, so I was like, yeah, I want to go too, man. And he was like, hey, so I got this former track athlete. And I was like, me? I was a walk-on like a motherfucker, man. Nigga, I didn't even get Hearns gear.
Right.
So
when you were walking on, they didn't give you clothes? They gave me clothes at least when I walked on.
I mean, I had the uniform.
It wasn't as much as everybody else, but
I had the fucking uniform I competed in on meet day.
Oh my gosh.
Hey, nigga, you wore the colors. That's all that matters.
I did wear the colors. I wore the colors about five times or so like that, yeah. Yeah, so. But I mean, yeah, so you got a better chance than me.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to see it. I feel like I haven't been to Columbia in a minute. I just want to go see, like, the campus. I'm sure the whole campus looks totally different. But I know they did a bunch of stuff to Brady.
Here's the thing, though. They got this facilities, and that is strictly for football. And I feel like it's going to leave the campus more segregated.
Mm-hmm.
Like, y'all get this, all this sparkling shit, and everybody else, y'all get what we left behind.
It's kind of always been like that, I feel like. At least when I was there, too.
I don't know. I mean, I felt like I used to see niggas in the weight room.
Yeah. So they have a whole separate weight room now, too?
It's in the stadium.
Oh. Oh, okay.
So they don't have to go outside the stadium anymore.
Oh.
They don't have to leave the stadium except for to go to class and to go to sleep.
Yep.
That's crazy. Because
okay. They got a dining hall in there.
Mm-hmm.
There's a dining hall in the stadium.
Yeah, there's definitely. I feel like that probably is going to lead to.
We had a dining hall. We had a dining hall. These niggas have a fucking cafeteria / restaurant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Damn. And then they got snacks and shit, too.
Mm. Nice. Do they have a separate training facility for, like, the personal trainers and stuff?
What do you mean?
Like, there used to be, like, one training room where everybody went.
Is there, oh, like, no, the training room's nice as hell, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, the training room's nice as hell. They got probably, what'd you say, about 15 tables up in there?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Which I guess is good, because I know when I used to have to go to practice and I had to, like, tape my ankle, and it was the same time that football was going, I was like, holy shit, it's going to take me forever to get my ankle taped. So that's good that they are separate for that reason. But I can see that making the other athletes kind of salty, having all that stuff separated. Especially if they ever get to see it.
Yeah, right.
Like, if they get to see what it looks like, and then they're like, oh, and we got this over here? Oh.
I'm telling you, they got the biggest hot tub in North America.
Mm-hmm. That's
I don't know. It's, and then they got a cold tub. It's just crazy.
And they got the cold tub like Scarface with 10 TVs around that bitch.
Yeah, oh, wow. Kind of take your mind off the ice baths. Mm.
And then what are those things in between the hot tub and the cold tub? It was some little...
Oh, the underwater treadmills?
Yeah, that's what it was, underwater treadmills.
Nice.
Oh, that's the live stuff we didn't mention, the underwater treadmills, and they have video cameras that can show progress so they can watch you while you're running on the treadmill.
They sure did. It was underwater like plow boxes too, wasn't it?
Wow. Yep. And all that's just for the football players? So as a track athlete, I hurt my hamstring, I can't use the underwater treadmill?
I don't know.
I would imagine that the other athletes can use the training.
I would imagine that they don't. You were on the football team. You don't know what life is like.
For us impoverished
for the track rest athletes. Of us. Oh, shoot. I'm just kidding, though. They might let other athletes use it for special occasions.
You might have to, come with a permission slip. You might have to, like, have an escort with you when you do, though.
Probably.
Escort?
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah.
They change the code as soon as you leave, so you can't come back in.
Yeah.
Oh, you're healed? All right, we changed the code today.
Indeed. And then the feature that was probably the funniest shit to me was they got the Golden Girls facility right at the entrance.
They don't even get to go into the place further than that?
They don't get to go into it, but as you were coming
this is where
out
you stop.
As you were coming out of the south into the stadium, you walk out, it is the Golden Girls facility, so they coming out, you know, say it all dolled up and shit like that.
Here was the irony. Joe notices the Golden Girls facility, the Golden Girls walk out, and then a recruiting bus pulls around the corner.
Right, like that.
Of course. Of course.
And then we heard about signing right after that, didn't
it? Of course. That convinced him right there. They got to see the ladies.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed.
Talk to them. Get up close and personal. Watch them dance.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
So.
All right, guys. I'm going to try to go to bed. I got to wake up and do a chain gang for another football game tomorrow. I'm just freaking
They got you out there slaving, huh?
Yeah. Make some money.
I think I'm done. I think I did my last game today.
I think tomorrow's my last. Put in my timesheet, get my money.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Again.
Holla. All
right, guys. Have a good night, guys.
All right. Good night. Good night, everybody.
Peace.
Peace.
Break bread with your brothers whenever possible.